Hey, what's up, guys? It's Ronald here, and welcome to the Sunday Debate. It is the 30th of September, and your weekend is officially over. I think this is going to be far more interesting than carte blanche, though. I've got Gwen and Gwenya, which is a member of parliament for the Democratic Alliance, and also the DA's head of policy. Gwen, how are you doing?
I'm well, and yourself?
I'm doing fine. And Sundays are my favorite days. You know, a lot of people complain about Sundays, but I enjoy Sundays because I get to interact with various different people. And I have to say that I think this Sunday is going to be easy because we both work for the Democratic Alliance. But I'd like to stress, though, that you and I both work for the DA, but I want to have a discussion with Gwen. Not, you know, the DA's Gwen, just like when I'm on this channel, I try and be as neutral as possible. But I do understand that we obviously are liberal individuals, and that will obviously move over. So instead of trying to put words in your mouth, I'll just hand over to you so that the people can find out who Gwen and Gwenya is. So over to you.
Well, I mean, you've already said that I'm a member of parliament, and also the DA's head of policy, although, as you've said, we're trying to have a more personal conversation as opposed to what the official party line may be. A little bit about my background, I think, if you wanted that. So I studied economics in Paris. I'll just start from there. And then I moved over and worked as an economic researcher. And then after that, I worked as a financial analyst at Bloomberg. And I've also been the CEO at the Institute of Race Relations, which I think many people are familiar with. And it was from there that I then moved over to the DA quite recently this year in March.
Okay, so let me start off. Like you started with Bloomberg and you moved into the Institute of Race Relations. Why politics? Why politics?
So, I mean, whilst I may be newer now in the sense that I've just recently rejoined, I've actually been quite actively involved in politics, ever since my student days. So when I was at GCT, as part of the first sort of DA student organization, SRC, so we're the first SRC around the country to have won under sort of the banner of the Democratic Alliance. And then the second term of office, I ran again after that year. So the first time I ran, I was vice president of the SRC. Then I ran again 2 years later, and I was then the president of the SRC. So I was quite involved in the early days of DASA and building it up as an organization, quite involved in student politics. And so that's always been something that I've had a deep interest in. But not so much, I would say. I mean, politics, I think, is the platform through which one can express their ideas. I think I've always been felt myself staunchly a liberal, and can maybe have a conversation about that. It seems to be a contested term these days. But especially deeply was sort of attached to the idea of being an individual and how we can ensure that individual expression finds itself or finds greater articulation in South African politics, which I find is not often the case. We're quite a sort of group think or maybe communitarian type of politics in South Africa. And I thought that individuality bit or about the individuals was missing or absent. But after, I would say, being involved in student politics when I was still at university, for various reasons, I think I became quite disillusioned with politics. And I mean, I still share many of those views still today about, you know, politics in general. Obviously, I'm generalizing, but in general, attracting relatively mediocre people who I think resort to career in politics because, quite frankly, they wouldn't be able to have a career anywhere else. Let's face it, politics is not a meritocracy. In many ways, it's a popularity contest.
It's
not purely just, oh, here's your CV or here's what you're able to do, and you select people on that basis. So I've always felt that it didn't attract the right sort of people. And so I didn't respect the people who are politicians. And I think when you're young, that forms part of what you aspire to, what kind of profession you'd like to do. If you look at people in that profession and you hold them in some kind of high esteem or high regard, and you say, well, I would quite like to do that, or I would quite like to become that when I'm older in the future. And I must say, in politics, there were a few people that I looked to and thought, oh, that's somebody that's impressive that I would you have as a personal role model. So I think because of that, the more I became disenchanted with the kinds of people who were politicians, the profession of politics sort of lost its appeal to me. And then more than that, I also just felt that many people, back again, I suppose, in the meritocracy argument, I didn't feel were really sort of inspiring individuals in terms of their views or their intellect. And I thought that it would be much more respectable if, in general, in politics, there were people who had gained expertise or were experts in some kind in another area, and then came back to politics to contribute that expertise. So I became averse to becoming a career politician. Now, obviously, if you get into politics quite young, the chances of you then staying in that career and becoming a career politician are quite great. So after university, I didn't immediately go into politics for those two reasons, that I didn't admire the politicians and I also didn't want to become a career politician. But after a while at Bloomberg, I think, you know, when you live abroad, at least this was true for me, when I was living in London or when I was living in, because I've lived in quite a few countries in the last few years. So I've lived in France, I've lived in India, I've lived in the UK. And every time when I was in those different countries, I think I was detached from the politics. Maybe because I didn't grow up there, and also quite realistically, if you're not a citizen, I think it's difficult to break through in a career in politics if you're not from that country. And so I think I was just focused on my professional job, and I was not focused on the politics of where I was living. I was focused on being a good economic researcher or being a good analyst. You know, it was only when I moved back to South Africa, I was still working with Bloomberg, but I was relocated from their London office to their South African office. And when I was in South Africa, I suddenly became very interested in the politics again. And I think, I suppose, many things frustrated me to a point where I was like, well, I'm kind of tired of commenting on the sidelines and moaning from the sidelines. If I'm going to be in South Africa, then I'd very much like to be involved in politics. But if I relocated, I'd probably then again move back to the corporate world or to the private sector. So I was at Bloomberg looking to sort of re-enter the political sphere somehow. And I've always been relatively close to Frans Grenier, who's the CEO of the IR. We had met we hadn't formally met in person, but we had got into contact when I was still a student. So when I was still a student at UCT, I had written an alternative admissions policy, because at the time UCT was having quite a heated debate around whether to continue with race-based admissions or look for an alternative way to admit students. And I firmly felt that students should be admitted on sort of a socioeconomic basis. Anyway, the point being that, you know, I reconnected with Frans. I knew that he presented there was a vacancy at the IR, and that's where I moved to. And I thought that was actually quite a comfortable place, because comfortable in the sense that it wasn't quite party politics, but being at a think tank that produces political and economic research and analysis, it's quite a happy medium between sort of being involved in the political space, but not quite belonging to a particular political party.
Yeah.
So that's basically how I made that move from the corporate world back into politics.
And the one thing, I mean, you see, the problem that I'm facing, and I'm sure that you're facing now that we are in opposition again in Nelson Mandela Bay, is that you are dependent on how other people behave, and that reflects on you. And I know how people perceive parliament, because if you look at what's going on in Nelson Mandela Bay and council, I'm really embarrassed. The other day when we had our council meeting afterwards, I posted a thing on Facebook saying, you know, I am so embarrassed to be considered a politician in Nelson Mandela Bay. Although I'm very proud to be part of the Democratic Alliance, I'm ashamed of what's going on. How do you find people to perceive you? I know, because people are supposed to judge people on an individual basis, but yet there's a stigma that follow, you know, you into parliament because of the antics that go on there.
Well, that's true. I think once you sign up to belonging to a particular organization, especially in politics, people, you know, anything that the organization or people in that organization say or do then become sort of a reflection on each individual inside that organization. So I think that's true, and it's hard to avoid, but I do try as much as possible to reinforce the idea that it's actually quite a healthy and positive thing for politicians to sometimes be able to remove that party political hat and speak on their own individual capacity. And I think it's quite a dangerous space when our politics become, you know, quite authoritarian, and that the moment that you join a political party, you lose all sense of individuality, and there's just, you know, only the party exists, the individuals in that party no longer exist. Mm. And I think particularly for a Liberal Party, that's something that we should push against. So I think Of course, for any organization, you know, if you have a party that's in government, there needs to be an official line. So don't get me wrong, I'm not at all saying there shouldn't be a party position on particular issues. But I think one should be able to say, this is the party position, and I also happen to agree with it or whatever, or this is the party position, but I also think X. And I think in more mature political organizations, and I think in more mature democracies, there's plenty of room for that kind of differentiation to happen. Certainly, I feel you see that in the US and the UK, where certain representatives may not necessarily buy into the official line. I mean, a good example of that is perhaps in the Tories, where there's quite a very public discussion or debate, perhaps, between those who are in the Conservative Party about the appropriate approach to take to Brexit. So I think all of that is healthy. It's obviously a much more difficult situation because you need to make sure that that debate doesn't then degenerate into intense factionalism that tears the political party apart. So I agree that it's a difficult thing to manage people having different views, but I also think it's worth protecting that space for differing opinions.
And what do you think about the second part of that? Was obviously the stereotype that, you know, people are the Afrikaans word gatvol of paying for parliamentarians, and they behave the way they do. I mean, I'm just referring to that stereotype. I think that a lot of people within the ANC and the EFF exemplify within parliament, because people want to tune in on how, for example, the EFF gets thrown out of parliament. But then as soon as we actually get to the president's speech, then people start tuning out. So how do you feel about being painted in sort of a negative light because you're a member of parliament based on the actions of other people in parliament?
I mean, it's not a great feeling, but as I say, I think it's hardly avoidable for that to happen. And the point is, I mean, people who might have a negative feeling towards paying politicians' salaries, well, it's the nature of democracy. If you want someone to do the legwork of representing you for, you know, I mean, there is work involved. Sure, some people don't do their jobs, but then you should by all means try and not have that political party where you feel no work is being done, they no longer represent you, to not vote them in. But I think if people are going to do the work that politicians are expected to do, and in the cases where they aren't doing it, they need to be paid a salary. I mean, what other incentive then would they be for someone to do that job? I quite like the system in other countries where most public representatives will have another job. So being a politician is not a full-time job. But I think we might have to structure things a little differently for that to be the case in South Africa. But that's a move that I would definitely support. I think being involved in, I mean, the real world, if one can call it that, I'm not saying politics isn't the real world, but I think being involved in another profession, working as a lawyer or an accountant, or even if it's a cashier, whatever it is, I just think that, you know, having some kind of occupation in the real economy and then bringing that expertise back into your political discussions is of some benefit. And I think on some level, the longer one is just purely a politician, there can be a kind of losing touch a little bit with the real world. I would certainly like a system like that, but as long as being a politician in certain structures remains a full-time job where there is no room or space to do another job, then unfortunately politician salaries will have to come out of the out of taxpayers or out of taxes and yeah. From taxpayers.
What is the most frustrating thing about being a member of parliament for you, or at least you know, within parliament? I'm just trying to get to let people understand perhaps what you know actually goes on and how much time it takes to be one.
Right. Well, so I'll say for myself, I mean, I'm on the finance committee. I can't speak for every single committee. I know some other committees don't meet as often, but I'm a member of the Standing Committee on Finance, and we meet quite regularly when Parliament is in session. And so I think that, and I think for many members of Parliament, that's where the majority of their work takes place, is in those parliamentary portfolio committees. That's where most of the legislation and discussion moves through those particular committees. And from Tuesday to Thursday, That's what you're focused on. And the time that a politician spends shouldn't just be in actually sitting in those committees. I mean, one also has to prepare. So if there's, for example, in the finance committee, if there's a discussion tabled for the nationalization of the Reserve Bank, a lot of research and perhaps speaking to experts and speaking to various stakeholders will be involved before you actually feel that you are well prepared to actually then participate in that discussion. So it's the extensive research and consultations that take place before a meeting that might be on the agenda. And then it's obviously sitting in those meetings as well. A lesser portion of one's time, well, particularly mine, is spent in the plenary, which I think is what most people see when they look at Parliament, when everyone is actually seated in plenary and is in the House. That part, I must say, needs a lot of work, and it is a waste of time for the most part.
Yeah.
A, it's an opportunity. Well, other people speak for extensive amount of time. The amount of interaction is very limited, and even the interaction that does take place is often not a proper way for a debate to occur. So a question will be asked, but the person speaking will rarely answer that question. And there's very rarely a mechanism to ensure the person does in fact answer the question. So it's a little bit like a bunch of people just shouting and screaming at each other and not really having a proper debate. So I think, yes, those discussions in plenary and what the public views must be incredibly frustrating for people watching at home. It's incredibly frustrating for people sitting in the House yeah. at the time as well. So I agree that that process needs a lot of work. And I can imagine that if South Africans are watching that, they aren't filled with much optimism about their politicians.
For sure. I see on the People's Assembly that you've got 100% attendance record. So well done. People are keeping track. I'm just letting you know. But
although I must say that might depend on the date. I mean, I don't want to be disingenuous. There's certainly, I don't know when last the timestamp is on that. I certainly have missed some other meetings, but sometimes it's necessary to do so. And it also depends on how you share the commitments with your team members on that particular committee.
For sure.
Some things may not be absolutely essential for one member to attend if that's not your sort of subject area, but you need to make sure that you attend others. So I certainly don't look down on people who have some sort of absenteeism on their record, as long as they're still absent from that meeting, but they're doing something else, which is related to their role as a parliamentarian.
For sure. All right. So let's move a little bit into social media and the effect that you have, that you think it's having on politics at the moment. What do you think the climate is currently with regards to how people perceive the current atmosphere? And I'm referring to social media in particular, especially the way in which everything seems to be race-based when you look at Twitter specifically. I know that you are quite active on Twitter, not sure about Facebook, but what is your take on how we are as a nation currently with regards to social media?
Well, I think not just in South Africa, but globally, the feeling is that conversation on social media is quite negative, and that it's not for the most part. I think it depends on which community you're in, but for the most part, people haven't felt it's a conducive way to have a discussion. Very rarely are people's opinions, I think, probably changed. It's just a platform for people to reinforce their existing biases, probably, and that's reinforced by the kind of people who might follow you, and the people that you follow, most people, I think, tend to follow people that they agree with and whose opinions they're interested in, and that can create a kind of reinforcing bubble. But I think for the most part, everyone is aware, or at least should be aware, that Twitter is not an accurate representation of society as a whole. And so although that's become almost something cliche to say, very few people behave as though that were true. So most times you'll find that we do have actual conversations that originate on social media and then become topics on TV shows or on radio, find their ways to the newspapers. So I think a lot of the public discourse does originate these days in social media. And I think that does limit our view to some extent, which is unfortunate. But the reason that happens, I think, is because most of the, or at least many policymakers, influencers, if you want to call them that, decision makers, certainly the media, are on social media. So I think that, you know, if you have a platform where the people in the public or in society who have the most influence in terms of impacting the public narrative, when they're on there, it's much easier for whatever is a Twitter debate to then become a national debate, even though it may not reflect or be a representative sample of what broader South Africans are thinking. But that's just what our journalists, our editors, our decision makers are attuned to, because they're all on that platform together.
I also think that media has become very lazy with regards to their reporting, and they rely on social media to give them information pretty much. I'm not sure how you feel about that.
Well, yes, I think that's just talking to the point that I was making, that many discussions or issues might originate on social media, and any journalist or editor that is then on Twitter or any other platform of social media, which many are, they then use whatever is topical or trending on Twitter to inform what they then discuss on their next talk show that they host, or their next TV show, or what they write in their next column. So definitely, if you have those people who are influencers picking up mostly only on the social media zeitgeist, then you do tend to find that what happens on social media becomes what is then reported on or what is spoken about in other mainstream media platforms as well.
And you'll find that, sorry, there's just a crazy echo. Okay, it's fine now. The one thing that I note that usually trends on social media is specifically politics and things that are related to politics. It's almost as if in South Africa, politics is the equivalent of what the Kardashians is in the United States. So in South Africa, you'll find that political things trend. For instance, whenever somebody acts in a racist way, and more specifically now, expropriation without compensation. And this also leaves a lot to be desired with regards to different political parties stating exactly where they stand. I mean, as the head of policy, I mean, can you certainly know where we as the DA stand on EWC. Would you like to just then give your personal opinion on that and make it clear so that people know?
Well, you've now said as head of policy, and then to make my personal opinion.
I'm sorry. I'm just as a policy person.
Yes, but I think actually my personal view accords with what the party position is. So this is one where perhaps I can wear a dual personal hat as well as the policy hat, to say that in terms of expropriation without compensation, the party is unequivocally opposed to expropriation without compensation. Now, one might say I should then just stop there, like put a bullet point after the party does not agree with expropriation without compensation. I disagree with that view. So if I continue talking, there are some who might view, well, you know, it's then moving into a gray area or trying to be far too nuanced, and it confuses things. But I think some debates are inherently complex, and it doesn't do the conversation any favors by trying to make them appear simpler than they actually are. So the reason I say that is that, yes, in principle, one can be opposed to expropriation without compensation, but it's worth just pointing out the difficulties that view might come across in the near future. So the one being that the Constitution provides for various measures of, if you could say, calculating compensation, and the broad measure that it should be just and equitable, and it highlights some others. But the point being that there is now discussion that just and equitable could mean no compensation in some circumstances. So I think we might have to swallow the fact that, at least from a legal or constitutional perspective, we might already have a dispensation which allows for expropriation without compensation, regardless of anyone's principled stance. And I think that's a point worth knowing or worth articulating. But my response to that, and it's something that I've always tried to put across, is that bad policies don't need to be unconstitutional or illegal. So we don't need to actually focus solely on what does the Constitution say or what does the law say. We can, from a policy perspective, say that we are opposed to expropriation without compensation. So I like to sometimes refer to other policies. I think it gives a good illustration of what I'm trying to get at. So, for example, in many of the education policies, or even if we look at the mining charter, or even if we look at BE policy, we could very well say those policies are bad policy ideas and list the reasons why those policies are bad. Either they will not actually meet their stated objectives, they will drive away investment, et cetera, et cetera. We can list policy reasons for why these policies are terrible. They don't rely on their being unconstitutional or illegal. So, for example, you know, if one takes, you know, as I said, perhaps even the mining charter or any other area where people commonly say there's policy uncertainty or the policy is bad, people very rarely say that the mining charter is unconstitutional. There might be constitutional arguments, but the principal arguments put forth are ones about deterring investment. Ones around mostly deterring investment. So I think similarly with expropriation without compensation, we shouldn't get bogged down by its constitutionality, because you can very well say something is constitutional and still say, well, it's bad policy, so we won't do it even though we legally can.
Mm.
And I think that's just something people need to get their heads around, which I don't quite think they are. People are quite stuck on the, is it constitutional? Is it unconstitutional? Do we need to change the constitution or don't we need to change the constitution? Whereas I'm a bit like, the constitution is slightly irrelevant. Even if it is constitutional, even if it is illegal, it's just a bad policy idea. So let's not do it. You don't have to do everything that's constitutional.
For sure. And I mean, you can just refer back to the laws during apartheid versus now. I mean, something that was legal during apartheid doesn't mean that it's right. So based on the principal stance that you said, that if it's a good policy, it's a good policy, it makes sense. And I just want to then take it to the extreme, because I think we can bridge this over into the hate speech argument and the fact that saying something like the K word can now land you up in prison. How do you feel about that? You know, as a constitutionalist or as an individual, as a liberal, what is your stance on that?
Well, I've never called myself a constitutionalist. So maybe I'll answer as a liberal.
Cool.
And we can explore, if you want to ask me about that point, we can go into a bit more detail. But I'm not going to go into a tangent about why I wouldn't call myself constitutionalist. I'll just answer the points about what do I think about people going to prison based on calling someone the K word. Firstly, I'd want to say that most of it rests on the law, which seems to be unique to South Africa, of crimen and jure, which, you know, basically revolves around the concept of dignity and having someone's dignity impaired or violated. So that's always been something, and I'm no legal expert, but just principally that's something that's always sat uncomfortably with me, because, look, I don't want to get into a deep philosophical discussion, but one, I think that from quite a Kantian perspective, that dignity is something that's innate. It essentially refers to one sort of humanness, the thing that makes us human. It's like an inherent value. It's almost like, in my view, akin to being a sentient being. Somebody can't take away your dignity. So dignity is not something that somebody else or the external environment confers on you. It's something that's innate to you as a human being. So I have a conceptual problem with the idea that dignity can be impaired or taken away. Sure, people can, you could say that perhaps people have treated you in a manner that one shouldn't treat somebody who is human being or someone that should, you know, how you should treat people based on human dignity. But I don't think you can say your dignity has been impaired. So that's the first thing. I think there's a conceptual, at least on my part, disagreement about whether dignity is something that depends or can be externally conferred, or whether it's something that's inherent and actually can't be taken away. Secondly, even if we were to concede that dignity is something that could be impaired, there's then a subjective discussion around, so can there be objective criteria that one can assess and say, based on these criteria, your dignity has been impaired? Or is it a subjective adjudication? I mean, can someone else tell me that my dignity has been impaired, even if I don't feel that my dignity has been impaired? So that's my second issue, is that I feel that the criteria for the impairment of dignity is also not something that's very clearly articulated. And I think it's open to abuse. And then thirdly, I have a deep issue, always had, with sentencing people, locking up people for nonviolent crimes. So words are not actions, or words are not deeds. And I think that there's some free speech issues to be discussed around whether we should be imprisoning people for things that they say as opposed to things that they do. There's obviously a criteria of hate speech, but I think it's quite important that hate speech, one considers that critical component of there being sort of imminent danger and imminent threat to that person. It cannot just be something that's offensive. So those are kind of my three main gripes around, I suppose, imprisoning people for what ultimately comes down to perceptions of racism. One about the concept of dignity and whether dignity can be impaired, as I said, around imprisoning people for nonviolent actions, and then that subjective adjudication of who decides when somebody's dignity has been impaired.
So what would you then...
It's deeply problematic. And I actually just wanted to add that, it, you know, maybe for some, it might seem like a radical idea to question the concept of dignity because it's so entrenched in our sort of human rights, you know, sort of framing or discourse in South Africa. But it's not really such a radical notion. I mean, I've done a bit of reading on this area. I said that doesn't make me an expert, but it is something I'm interested in and have certainly looked up. And there are actually some interesting discussions out there around dignity, and there isn't as much consensus around it globally as one might think. In fact, two top judges in the European Court of Human Rights also said that it's a dangerous notion that's open to misinterpretation. So I think you can find some credible legal experts out there who also are quite dubious about, you know, about dignity being used for sentencing.
For sure. But what then, in your opinion, would you consider a good enough punishment? Do you think just slapping them with a fine would be something that assists? Because, I mean, I disagree with you on this stance. That I do think that considering our history and considering the fact that, you know, we are so sensitive when it comes to racism, and rightfully so in this country, I do think that it sets us a little bit apart from other countries that might not have the history that we have. And the crimen in jura argument is something that we can debate time and time again. But I do think it needs to serve as a deterrent. And I don't know what your stance is on racism, whether you would rather want people to be racist to your face and you know it, or if you would rather want people to keep their racism, you know, behind closed doors. How do you feel? Maybe that's a good point to start and we can go from there.
Well, firstly, I mean, it's not to say that I don't think there should be any kind of you know, that people who are racist, there should be no sort of societal consequences for that. I just don't think that the consequence should be a prison sentence or serving jail time. Even the concept of racism is quite problematic. As I said, it comes down to very often to very subjective judgments of whether something was in fact a racist action or racist utterance or not. And so there's very selective application of the law in that regard. Also, I'm always reminded of this quote by, I think it's in Macbeth, King Duncan says it, that there's, you know, no art, that there's no art in finding the mind's construction in the face. Basically, you know, just meaning that you can't look at someone and tell what they're thinking. Yeah. And I find racism is a lot like that. It's very difficult to tell from outward actions or appearances about what is innately, I think, a subjective assessment, you know, calling someone a racist. And we've seen it before, that the one thing can be said by one person and it's deemed racist, and somebody else can say the exact same thing and it's not seen as racist. So I find the adjudication of that quite problematic. But it's not to say there can't be societal consequences. I mean, there actually often are. So, you know, in terms of private companies, if somebody behaves in a way that you don't think represents your company in a proper manner, or you don't think aligns or accords the brand of your company, I actually find no problem with companies firing people who they think have been racist. Most of the time, I'd say as long as they generally feel there has been some kind of negative impact on the company's brand or for their reputation, not just because they've you know, reacting momentarily to some kind of mob that by the next day would have actually jumped onto another issue and won't care. So I would assess about how long-term the damage is to one's company about retaining that person. But anyways, all of those kinds of assessments and considerations are up to that particular manager, owner of the company. But I think, you know, those kinds of private decisions do occur, and they're probably, you know, quite right, because you have a right to, I suppose, have your company associated with whoever you think is fit to be associated with your company's brand and who might be good for your company's reputation. So I think the firstly, there are those kinds of repercussions that often come from one's private relationships. There's usually social repercussions as well. People won't want to associate themselves typically with someone who's seen as a racist or a sexist or bigot in any other sense. And often those people are shunned. There's quite widespread public they are rebuked publicly on various platforms. So I don't think it's true that without the law doing something, that there's no repercussions for behaving in that way. We've evidently seen in many instances that there actually are repercussions.
Mm. Yeah.
Those kind of social ostracization, losing one's job, all of those potential consequences aren't enough, and that the law needs to step in. I suppose that's where we would disagree, is that I don't think that the law needs to step in. And where it does, I would definitely then limit it to being fines or community service or compelling them to take some kind of, although I'm a bit dubious about some of the sensitivity courses that exist. Mm-hmm. And their whole ideological framing. But the point is, there are numerous options. They have to attend some kind of therapy or community service. I mean, I'm just saying there are many options where we can think outside the box. I'm deeply averse to prison time for nonviolent actions.
Do you think that,
fundamentally, I think the only people that should be locked up are people who present some kind of physical threat, either to themselves or to society. But I don't see people who say things being, a fair or proportionate sentence to have them locked up.
Well, don't you think, let me ask this, because I mean, I come from a psychological background and I know the damage that it can do. Don't you think that somebody that gets verbally abused day in and day out and sort of get affected in such a way that their mental capacity is affected by it, don't you think that that can also perhaps be considered a good enough reason to put somebody behind bars?
Very rarely, no. In most cases, I mean, I'm not going to try here and think up of every single instance, and I'm not going to be confident enough to say absolutely there's no such scenario. But I don't think for the most part that that's the default position. I would care about making sure that victims of verbal abuse do have options to get themselves out of that situation. So I think that that kind of person should be removed from the workplace, for example. That's one way to remove them from being a further threat or harm to those people in that workplace. If it's a domestic situation of verbal abuse, we should be providing options for where those victims can seek shelter or perhaps even have a restraining order. I just think there are options which primarily revolve around trying to put some distance between the verbal abuser and the abuser and the victim. And I think those are the options that should be explored.
For sure. Do you think that we as a nation are obsessed with race?
Being paid as well, to the extent that person, there's any kind of financial losses they've incurred as a result of that abuse.
Yeah, sorry. I think there was a little bit of a delay. I just wanted to ask, do you think that we as a nation are obsessed with race over other things that are, I would dare say, more important? For instance, the murder rate in this country, the rape rate, and various other serious, serious crimes?
Well, I do think that this country does think a lot and is very politically animated by race, but I also don't think it's accurate or fair to say that race trumps all other issues. Or rather, that's not the way that we should be looking at things that concern us. So, I mean, we're capable of caring about many things at the same time. So it would be ridiculous, for example, if I got up tomorrow morning and decided to protest outside an abattoir and say that, it's unethical to slaughter sentient beings. And then for somebody to say to me, well, as an MP or even just as a South African, why have you decided to use this day to protest against animals being slaughtered? Do you not care for humans that are being slaughtered? I mean, that's not fair. We can express outrage on different issues at different points in time. And certainly once time is limited, and I think it's quite right in society that, for example, I actually do care about animal rights, for example, but have I done much actively about it? No. But I'm happy that there are others, whilst maybe I'm mostly worried about the economy or focusing on those debates, that there are people who are less involved in championing issues around the economy and instead are focused on animal rights. And I think allowing that kind of diversity means that important issues that need to be tackled are tackled by different groups of people. But I don't think it's fair to then approach somebody who has taken up a particular cause and say, well, why this cause and not another cause?
Yeah.
We can't possibly all take up every single cause that aggrieves us.
I think what stood out for me about that specific thing was what was his name? Katsavelos. As he was, that video of his released where he used the K word, I actually had a guest on the Sunday debate called Lindsay Marstorp. I'm sure you know who he is, from BLF. And he was on this Sunday debate and he made an outlandish statement, like a ridiculous statement, where I asked him, well, according to him, firstly, every single white person in this country is racist. And then based on that, I said, is there ever an instance where he would stand with a white individual? And then he said, never. Then I pushed him further and I said, okay, so if there is a black individual that rapes a white individual, would you not stand with that white individual? He said, no. And then he cited an example of a serial rapist, I believe in Cape Town. And he, in essence, said that he would stand with a rapist over, you know, a specific race. And then when I tagged many media houses on social media, nobody responded. So that is just why I was leading to that, because I think everybody was so caught up in the hype of nobody using the K word, and they excused actually somebody that's a spokesperson for a political party that will be standing for election in 2019 that endorses rape. I mean, that in itself is mind-blowing.
Well, yes, in terms of identical issues, which that sort of is, I mean, those are very similar scenarios, but them being treated very differently. Yes, it is abominable that they do so. And I think largely they assess what is perhaps the most sensationalist or what captures the public imagination at that time and decide to report on that as opposed to something else. So, yes, I mean, I think we share that view that the media is not perhaps entirely or doesn't afford the same amount of coverage to issues that are actually very similar in nature as they should.
Yeah.
But I mean, that also speaks to a broader issue around there being a large consensus actually in South African media. Sure, there are publications, and I wouldn't ever want to say every single media house or every single journalist is problematic. That's definitely not the case. There are some excellent journalists and those who try and maintain the objectivity. But I also wonder whether it's actually perhaps unfair to expect journalists to be as objective as the African environment expects them to be. I mean, you have many journalists that actually have a past or a history themselves. You know, either they've also been members of political parties or currently are members of political parties, so which means that they are deeply sympathetic to one worldview or ideological view over another. And I think there's nothing wrong with that, but it does become problematic if there isn't then people to fill up an alternative space. So I think the problem is not so much that there are too many, for example, journalists on the left, rather that there aren't enough journalists with more center or more liberal views. And obviously I use liberal in the South African or UK sense, not liberal in the American sense, where liberal and left would be on the same side. Mm. I mean, kind of in our sense, where liberal and left would be on two different sides usually of an argument or of a debate. So I think that there isn't probably enough more liberal media who understands liberal ideas, and perhaps less so in a social sense. I think when it comes to social issues, perhaps there's more consensus there. But I think especially when it comes to economic issues, there's not enough people who understand liberal economics. In fact, I think many report on liberal economics in a quite a pejorative sense, calling it neoliberal and whatever other words they choose to use. And I think that's fair enough in an environment where you would have a counterbalancing viewpoint. But the problem in South Africa is there aren't enough of those counterbalancing viewpoints. I mean, I always use the UK as an example, not that it's a shining light of journalism or media, you know, by any stretch of the imagination. I'm not trying to say that their media environment is perfect. I mean, I think there's a lot that's toxic about the British press as well. Mm. But however, I think people do generally have a sense, if they pick up The Guardian, the kind of analysis they would get. I mean, it's relatively, one might say, center, but you still have a sense of what you're getting if you read The Guardian, as opposed to if you pick up The Telegraph, as opposed to if you pick up a magazine like The Spectator. And I think that kind of diversity benefits everyone, as opposed to journalists hiding and columnists and everyone else in the media space hiding their ideological stances and pretending to be objective. Because I think as much as you try, your leanings will always color the way that you report on news, which issues you pick up on as important. So I think we place an unfair burden actually on the media in South Africa by expecting it to be so objective. Perhaps it might be better if people were a little bit more partisan and honest about their partisanship, but then if there was a broader spectrum of that. The danger now in being partisan is that there's probably not enough, as I say, on the liberal side of reporting.
Yeah, I tend to agree because, I mean, well, I think that the media is too left, almost. If you look at the way in which Adrian Basson and various other people report on the media, as an example, when Musi Maimane would say something, then the media would report on it as if that was factual and that's the end of it, and there's no considering perhaps that he meant something different. Whereas if you look at currently what Cyril Ramaphosa said in that interview with the Donald Trump tweet, the media was far more forgiving to try and come up for Cyril Ramaphosa to say, well, maybe that's not what he meant. And I don't see them doing that for anybody other than the president. And even, well, I think maybe they'll do it for Julius Malema to an extent. But then again, I don't think that they would afford, for instance, Musi the opportunity, or that opportunity at least.
Yeah. But as I say, if I'm trying to interpret it at my most generous, it's because people do have their viewpoints, and it's very difficult to expect people for those innate views to not come through or to find articulation in how they cover stories and the stories they choose to cover. So the problem is that there's no counterbalance to that. And you're right, they're far more likely to read into what people on the left say, because I think they also come from the left, so they are able to read into what they say. It's not just, for example, Ramaphosa's statement on that tweet. It goes even back to when there was a whole discussion around radical economic transformation or white monopoly capital. The ANC were very thin on details of what these terms mean, but there was no shortage of columnists, analysts, commentators who wrote lengthy pieces trying to fill in the gaps on behalf of the ANC. When they say radical economic transformation, this is what they're trying to say and why. And, you know, so there was no shortage of people trying to fill the gaps that, in fact, the ANC should have been filling. Mm-hmm. Alternatively, with the DA, if we speak of an open opportunity society, because there is a dearth of people who actually share liberal values, there will be few people who will fill in the gaps for us and say, this is what they mean. Instead, they will say to us, oh, that's rather thin. Can't you provide more details? There'll be less people who can actually read into what our values mean. And we have to do a lot more legwork in explaining and fleshing out those details. Whereas if there were a lot more people who had read Karl Popper and perhaps agree with those views, they would have no problem in immediately understanding what the open society refers to. But we have to do a lot of explanation because a lot of people don't come from that ideological worldview.
Mm. And I mean, there is this one thing that's said in politics, that if you have to explain your stance, you're losing. And I think that one of the most memorable moments for me on TV, especially with regards to the DA, was when you were on, I think it was the SABC, and Adams Roots was the host. And then obviously the statement came out that, you know, how would you consider the DA as, or how would you defend the DA's position as a white party? And without provocation, you actually came back and you said, well, firstly, the DA isn't a white party. The DA is a party for liberal-minded people. And that is something that I have to give you loads of credit for, because a lot of people have this misconception. And the fact that you can actually go and just make a statement like that and speak to the truth of the matter, rather than, you know, what the media is portraying and what the opposition is portraying, it's commendable.
Well, thanks. But I think, I mean, it's also just something, a trap that even I would say DA members or people sympathetic to the DA fall into, to say that, well, we're alienating our base, and mostly talking about white South Africans. And I'm at pains on every occasion I can get to say that our base are not wealthy people or white South Africans. That might be the truth if you demographically break it down. But I think that those attributes are incidental or just mere coincidence. The real base are people that are liberals. Sure, there might be some kind of correlation that people who hold liberal values tend to be more educated, tend to be of a certain socioeconomic status. And because of that, the fact that you need to be, or the fact that most people who hold liberal views are educated and are generally of a higher socioeconomic status, with South Africa's history, that will then also mean that they are most probably in the majority white. But that's really a consequence of other factors, not necessarily that we are trying to only attract white voters, or that certain ideals can only be held by white South Africans.
Mm. And then how does it affect you being a person of color in the Democratic Alliance? Do you get a lot of sort of flack for it? Because I've seen what people have said on Twitter to members of the DA that are part of the party that aren't white. Firstly, do you take it to heart? Do you care about it? Do you even consider yourself, I mean, everybody has their culture and their heritage, and that's fine, but is it important to you firstly, and or is that just a byproduct of who you are firstly after being a South African?
No, I don't care, but just because I don't care doesn't mean those things aren't important. So I think if other people see Black people who are in the DA being ostracized and people saying certain things, I think it can make others then more afraid to face that kind of stigma and to join. So I think it's important that we speak out against it, even though I don't personally feel anything about being called terms like a house Negro or porch Negro. I mean, it's usually said by people who don't affect my life. I don't care about them at all. They mean nothing to me.
Yeah.
You know, I just don't care. But it's not to say that one shouldn't confront them about that particular, about saying that, because there will be people who are not in my position who perhaps are more vulnerable to those kinds of comments, who will be ostracized maybe by their families, their friends, for holding contrary political views. So I think it's important to speak out against that and why it's problematic, even if it doesn't hit home for me personally. And on the broader question around identity, I mean, no, I don't really feel attached to my race or even to any kind of ethnic heritage. You know, some people say because people will ask, you know, how do you feel as a Black South African or even as a young South African? And I always tell people, I don't know how to answer that. I mean, I don't know what I feel as a woman or as a young person, as a Black person. I just know what I feel as Gwen. I mean, I can't feel the counterfactual. So I couldn't say if I would feel differently if I was white or if I was male or if I wasn't the things that I currently am. And I think that's true for most people. Most people speak from their own personal perspective and try and extrapolate that to the group. But at the end of the day, I think it's mostly our own individual feelings. These aren't group feelings. These are personalized feelings.
Mm. It's so amazing to you say that, because I've also found myself in that position where I almost want to say that many people, and I can't speak for other people in the organization, but I do think many people have moved beyond the fact that, yes, okay, I am white and therefore I'm an Afrikaner and therefore, you know, the history and all of these things. I just think that, you know, from my side, I think that we as an organization are trying to already move beyond that and consider, you know, what can we do for South Africans? Because we definitely are the most diverse party in South Africa. And I think, you know, like I said, I can't speak on behalf of other members and other people, but I do think that identity is important. Yes. I love the fact of, you know, the history where I come from and the culture, but it's not a deciding factor for me. It's not something that makes me go, okay, well, I need to live according to this because of my history. And I think you just basically said the same thing with regards to what your history and cultural background is.
I mean, I understand people who find those aspects, well, I don't understand it. I'm just saying I intellectually understand it. I accept that there are people who, for whom their heritage is important to them. But I think just from a young age, I have an aversion to anything that's inherited because I didn't choose it. So I find it bizarre to be attached to things that I didn't choose. I mean,
preach.
Christian, or just because my parents, I mean, by the arbitrary circumstance of birth, I happen to be born a certain skin color, or just because I happen to be born into a Zulu family instead of a Sotho family, why should I continue with Zulu practices or customs? It's completely arbitrary. I could have just easily been born into a Sotho or a Xhosa home. I mean, I'm not particularly interested in things that I had no part in choosing. And I suppose the most demonstrable, action that I've taken, which shows that, and look, it wasn't a political statement. I actually just chose it because I did that because I wanted to, but I suppose it reflects that I'm not particularly tied to things which are assigned to me, is that I changed my name, you know? So people who've known me since primary school or much earlier in my life, actually even some who've known me perhaps sort of later high school and early university would have known me by my English name, Amanda, or my Zulu name, Snethemba. So my parents gave me two names, Amanda and Snethemba, but I changed my name to Gwen. I just didn't particularly like any of those other two names. And some people think that's quite a drastic move, but for me, it's not. I mean, it's like, why not? I mean, I want to be called Gwen. And so,
yeah,
almost like everyone, when they reach of age, should be able to decide, well, actually you are, but not many people think about it. What would you like your name to be? Why do you have to be called something that somebody else decided you should be called? Look, that might be a bit more radical for most people, but I'm just saying that in general, I see no reason to continue with practices or with ideas just because they were sort of passed on to you. I think the great part of life or living is to almost create the individual that you want to be. And if you're not actively involved in that creation process and you're just sort of passively going through life with inherited, you know, everything being inherited, I just find that quite boring.
For sure. There's a lot of people in the comment section that's loving you, and they hope that you stand soon for president of South Africa. But people, you can ask questions. I think we're going to wrap it up in the next 10 minutes. I'm not sure how long Gwen has. But maybe, Gwen, if you see something interesting in the comment section that you'd like to answer, you're more than welcome to. Otherwise, if there's anything that I missed that you would just like to speak on.
No, you can ask me questions from the comment section. I've actually been trying to link up to them, but for whatever reason, I can't actually see the comments.
Okay, well, if there's anything interesting, then I'll ask.
Or something else, but you can just sort of selectively, I don't know, at random, choose any questions.
So next year's the elections. What do you think is going to happen percentage-wise during the elections? Where do you think the various political parties will end up? And do you think a coalition is on the rise? And sorry, I'm not trying to interrupt you by coughing, but there's just something in my throat. There we go.
Well, firstly, I don't like thumb-sucking answers. And so there are a lot of people who like to make predictions, etc. But unless I have developed a model on my own and it's based on something credible, then I don't like to thumbsuck. All I can say is, well, I think the RR's latest poll is very credible. I've looked at their methodology. I think it's quite sound. So the kind of snapshot view at present is that, you know, we have the EFF on 13%, the DA on 23%, and the ANC on 52%. Now, polls aren't predictions or forecasts. They can be designed or have extra modeling that enables them to have some kind of predictive properties. But this one is just a standard snapshot poll. So what do people think right now if the election were to be today? And that's, it seems, where it stands. I can't say or speak to the events between now and the election that might influence dramatically people's voting intentions. So I'm not really one to play in the thumb-sucking game of what's going to happen. I think it's much better to be prepared for various scenarios as opposed to looking ahead to one future. So I think there's one scenario in which the DA is pretty much stable from the last election to the present one. And so we remain at 22% or grow very marginally at around 23%. There's a scenario where perhaps along with other opposition parties performing well, the ANC gets driven below 50%, which might open up the opportunity of a coalition government. And then, you know, I think the less likely scenario is where the DA wins outright. Of course, some people might like that to happen. I just don't think it's very likely. But of course, one can never say never.
Oh, there we go. You're back. Sorry, you just lost you there for a second.
Right.
Yeah. So sorry, I just lost the last bit of your sentence. You were saying that the DA wins outright. That's not very likely.
Yes, basically I'm saying that one should look at a set of scenarios of different things that could happen. And yeah. So yes, there is a scenario where the DA wins, you know, outright, so above 50%. I'm just saying I think that would be the least likely of all the possible scenarios.
Meerkat is asking here about what your opinion is on Julius Malema and the EFF at large, and how do you think the DA will do with the rural votes?
Right. I think the rural vote historically has been quite difficult for the DA to penetrate. I think that will remain true even for the next election. I don't think very highly, and perhaps that's a slight euphemism of the EFF. I mean, they're racial nationalists. There's nothing that I can find to relate to in that message. And more than being racial nationalists, they're also populists. I think many of their positions are deeply irresponsible and target people's deepest fears. And I think as politicians or leaders, they use that, you know, they use those kinds of fears to trump up hatred and racial divisions as opposed to providing solutions that could lead to a more unified and politically stable country. So I think they're a very dangerous element in South African politics. And I think it pushes our discourse a lot more to the left, but not just any left, but a deeply identitarian and a politics driven by racial discourse. And I think that's a problem. And obviously the more to the left we move, the more conservative or right wing people who are actually quite reasonable seem. So that for me is the biggest concern that, you know, for example, I myself, by what many people might deem credible journalists, have been described as conservative or right wing. Now, when I'm right wing, I think you need to be very scared because
you know, same, yeah.
I'm actually quite in the, you know, the center of debate, but it just shows how the more you have elements like, you know, BLF and the EFF pushing the left agenda even further and further to the left, everyone gets dragged along with them. So currently, if we're all here, but the left keeps pushing, then we're all being driven towards the left and suddenly very moderate views appear to be far right or radical. And I think that's certainly something that's very concerning.
Yeah, I mean, I fully agree with you. And I mean, there was instances over the last couple of weeks where that's taken place. I've actually made mention to my personal thing where I've been accused of being a social justice warrior and a far right so much that I'm actually dizzy. Which means that I must be center, because if people are accusing me on either sides of being the other, then surely I am in the center and I'm quite comfortable there. There is a question, though, building on what you said about Julius Malema, and I had this discussion with Roman Kabanak. You were on the Renegade Report, by the way. For those of the people that are watching that would like to listen to Gwen on the Renegade Report, it was a really, really really good interview, very interesting, so be sure to check that out. But just to ask you, do you think that Julius Malema is highly intellectual and he's just playing the game, or do you think that he has no clue, but because of the support that he gets, that people think that he's intelligent? What is your stance on that?
Oh, intelligence is a very difficult concept. I mean, there are some ways in which I think the EFF and Malema himself, their positions are quite stupid. So, you know, most of their stuff around the economy, I just think is poorly thought through. It lacks any credible research, driven more by ideology than any kind of empirical evidence. So I'm not impressed by them in that kind of policy sense. But there's no doubt that they're obviously people who have a lot of street smarts, and I think that they are good politicians in the sense that they know how to play the game of politics. Not good politicians in the sense that they're what people should sort of see as role models and vote for, but as in they know how to play the political game. They know how to capture the public imagination, give very compelling speeches. But I also do think that that kind of political savvy is much easier to have when you are spreading a populist message. It's much harder to be compelling when you are saying things that are right, that are complex, that are nuanced. You can't out EFF the EFF on populism. You can't do it if you're saying things that are very rational and sober and sort of on the moderate ground. If you want to compete with them and out EFF the EFF, then you yourself have to start becoming quite absolutist, quite extreme. And I think that's also another danger of the more extremist politics, is that the more outrageous the left is, the more outrageous people expect the response to be. And going back slightly to the expropriation without compensation point, I think the DA's view, and certainly my view, has been a little bit more nuanced, but it is actually, if you look at land reform, especially as a package, a very difficult and complex debate. But because the EFF is so resolute, almost has one line on it, you know, we want the land back kind of thing. If somebody else has that clear a message, people then expect you to also have a slogan in response. Whereas the EFF has a slogan on expropriation without compensation, we're trying to have a considered policy position. And those are two different things. But if we're also going to be forced to have a slogan in response, you kind of push everyone to the radical extremes of the debate. So that's what they end up doing. And that's how they've affected, I think, the political discourse. Is everyone is now trying to play catch up to that kind of political savvy. But the danger of that is that it's going to be a lot more superficial once we all resort to sloganeering.
Definitely.
By posters, I think.
There's a running joke that's obviously going on with me and my subscribers of me trying to get somebody with more degrees than what I have on the show. And there's a question in the comment section from Meerkat. How many degrees do you have?
How does one count that? I suppose two.
Two degrees. No,
I don't have more than one postgraduate degree. Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah, it's your undergrad, and then if you
how many degrees do you have? Why do people think you're trying to get people?
No, it's a joke. It's a running joke because it's an internal thing. It's not anything to try and say that you need to have degrees. I mean, I've got four, and that's the joke. Okay. The joke is that I tell people I've got four degrees. So
that's quite impressive.
Well, thank you. You're the only person that thinks that's important. So really, thank you for that.
No, of course, I would never disparage having degrees.
You hear that, guys? You hear that? Important. And people respect you in this chat. So guys, respect what Gwen said there, please. It's important. I think let's close down this debate by asking, what policy or policies do you think is really important for us to tackle, considering you are a policy person, in order to immediately turn things around in this country?
Oh, well, that's difficult to wrap up question, but essentially we have to get our set of economic policies right. And I say set because, I mean, the economy is not just one thing, you know, there's so many areas that feed into it. But ultimately, I think many of our problems or our disagreements arise from economic or class disparities more than they do out of racial divisions, etc. And so I think if we can get the economy to grow, for more people to have jobs, but most importantly, not just any jobs, but the more people we can get into jobs that actually pay a high enough income where people can meet their day-to-day expenses, but also importantly, start to save and invest. That's very important. I mean, I've become slightly obsessed is the wrong word, but just quite attuned in policymaking to the fact that we have to think about wealth accumulation, how people can accumulate wealth. And I think that's also where this land discussion fits in, is that ultimately there's this idea that if we give more people land, it's a way to redistribute the wealth in the country. I'm a little bit skeptical of that view, because if the end goal of land redistribution is wealth accumulation, it's worth bearing in mind that, for example, last year, only 12% of wealth in South Africa was created through property, and that 88% of wealth generation comes from exposure to the financial markets. So actually most passive income generation is people who are investing in financial markets in one way or another. So I think actually if the end goal is wealth accumulation, we should be rather far more focused in terms of getting people to save and invest, as opposed to the narrow view that actually property is the only way to do so. But I think ultimately it's getting our economic policies right. And I think, you know, if we really do care about the future of the country, the wedge issue in the next election should be the economy. The party with the best economic offering, ultimately, I think, should be the party that people are voting for. And to put any other discussions aside, but really try and focus on that, you should try and find a compelling economic message and place your vote behind the party that is able to provide you with one.
I do also think that the EFF jumping on this land issue is pretty much what the ANC's been doing, I think 5 years ago or 4 years ago for the 2014 elections, when they promised housing. And because they didn't deliver on the housing, now they're just trying to jump on something else that they didn't promise before, that people can't call them out on. And that is why the ANC is so obsessed with expropriation without compensation. Even though we've seen time and time again through the statistics that people honestly don't care about land. But because the political parties, specifically the ANC and the EFF, are shouting so much about it, that people start caring without knowing that majority of the people don't actually care. I don't know if you have a comment on that.
Well, quickly, I mean, it kind of goes back to the previous comment that I made around prioritization of issues. And I'm not quite sure I would phrase it that way and saying that people don't care about land. But when confronted with other problems, or when asked which problems rank highly for them, yes, other issues do rank higher than land, but that's not to say that land is not important. I mean, similarly, as I said, might care about animal rights, but asked, if I'm asked to rank issues, what do we need to fix tomorrow or immediately, you know, I might say crime, the economy, before I get to animal rights, but it doesn't mean I don't care. It just means that you would prioritize those different issues differently. So I think land, the discussion around land is important. But yes, it is useful to bear in mind that there are perhaps more pressing issues that people would place above land. And we're almost crowding out the entire debate or public space at the moment with solely the land issue, when actually people have indicated that there are other areas they would prioritize before land. And as I said as well, making sure that even when we do talk about land, being quite clear about what the end goal is. Are we talking about people needing land back for sentimental reasons? Are we talking about people needing land back in order to accumulate wealth, in which case getting land is not the only way to accumulate wealth? And why aren't we talking about the entire spectrum of wealth accumulation, how people can do that aside from just acquiring land? Or are we talking about land, the end goal being housing, because people are homeless and don't have shelter close to areas of work, etc.? So the end goal should actually be framing what our strategies and our solutions are. And unfortunately, we don't discuss enough about land to what end. And I think if we can be clear about those, you know, what the end goal is or what the end goals are, and we can prioritize that way, the discussion will be a lot more fruitful.
Yeah, I do think that land, it means nothing to own land and you can't make a profit from it. And I believe, you can correct me if I'm wrong, because you actually worked for the IRR, is that I believe that 97% of all land claims have been settled. So the argument of dispossession, it might still be valid in some cases, but it's not really the main driving force behind EWC today.
No, I think the statistic you're referring to is regards to how many people opt for financial compensation. So I'm not quite sure of the exact number, but I think it is that over 90% of land claimants have opted for financial compensation over the land itself. Now, that's also, I mean, I don't know if we're wrapping up. That's also quite an...
if you've got more time, I mean, I can go another 10 minutes if you want to.
That's an area that requires a bit more detail as well. So some people might use the fact that people so many people choose financial compensation as an indicator that people don't want land, but that wouldn't be entirely accurate. I mean, one, it also depends on having well-located land. So yes, if someone is in Johannesburg, it obviously makes sense that if they're being offered land somewhere extremely far from where they are, not close to their current, you know, not close to work opportunities or not close to their family and friends, they probably will choose financial compensation. Secondly, if the system of acquiring that land is overly complicated, they might think they have to wait much longer. You know, there's all sorts of bureaucracy to get through. And so faced with that mountain of obstacles, perhaps still in front of you, many people might see a quick buck as much better than the hard slog of eventually getting title to that land. And sometimes, in fact, they never do, you know. So I think there are many reasons why people might choose money, but not necessarily that all of them are choosing the money because they don't want land. Maybe they do, but they just think the process will be overly drawn out or it will be too far from where they live, and so it's not practical. So I think there are many considerations or many reasons why people might opt for financial compensation.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, so I just think that that's a little bit more nuanced. I wouldn't draw the absolute line that because more people choose to be financially compensated, they don't care about land.
Yeah. Okay, and now for the most difficult question out of all of them. I've left this for last. What's your opinion on weed legalization?
Oh, I think it's fantastic.
Great. Now we can be friends.
Now, sometimes practical, look, there are many even in our own party or liberals. So some things I don't think are, not every issue I think is a matter of ideology. I mean, there are some things that perhaps just on the empirical evidence or the data, you might feel one way or another. So I was quite compelled by the, it seemed there was a growing movement, I haven't really kept in touch, but in the US especially, about fighting the war on drugs. And there was a lot of compelling messages or research coming out there that actually the war on drugs has been a net bad as opposed to a net good, and actually there should be other ways to tackle drug abuse and the other ills that come perhaps from drug use aside from criminalization and the heavy sort of security approach that has been taken with drugs. So in that view, I think if the evidence supports that the war on drugs has been a failure, we should probably be moving away from criminalizing all drugs, not just weed, and finding other ways to deal with drug abuse and maybe criminal activities that tend to be linked to to drugs, etc.
I agree, because it's not working currently. Whatever we're doing, it isn't working, specifically in South Africa.
Well, yes, and again, and by not working, I mean, look, you might find that greater securitization or a more sort of a security approach does bring down the drug use rate in some areas. But I would also view the not working in terms of the many people that go to jail because of drugs. Again, going back to my point that I have an aversion to sending people to prison for nonviolent crimes. I don't think people who are selling or using drugs should be in prison. They need some other form of intervention, and I don't think a prison sentence is it.
Good. All right. I think that's a great place to end it. I just want to thank you for coming onto the show, and thank you for a different pace. It was very nice to, and no disrespect to Roman, I mean, that was fantastic too. But I've had so many hostile people, and I think it's just fantastic to have somebody that actually, you know, has a lot to contribute, not only to society, but also to South Africa at large. So thank you very much for that.
Are you trying to say Roman has nothing to contribute to society?
Well, he's an anarchist. I mean, Roman knows he's got nothing. He just wants to create anarchy. That's just a joke. But listen, where can people follow you? Because there's a lot of people that are interested in following and keeping up to what Gwen's doing. So what can they do?
Well, I suppose to follow me on Twitter. I don't really have my own website or a politician's page and all those sort of things. Maybe when I become more famous, I might think that there's a reason to do that. But for now, Twitter seems to be just fine. And I mean, I suppose because I am a public rep, I tried the whole two phones thing, one phone for public duties and one phone for personal. And it just, for me, maybe for some people it works, for me it doesn't. So actually, I have one phone and it's open to everyone. I don't know. It's weird. It's open to everyone, but maybe I don't want to share it on. I don't want to share it on YouTube. But no. Certainly, if people send me a message on Twitter and ask for my number, I will open up my DMs or I will contact them and happily give them my cell phone number and my email address. Both of those are public information in South Africa. I suppose saying it out on YouTube would make it public information globally. So maybe I don't want to do that.
For sure, for sure. Now, I will link your Twitter in the description below for the people that's watching it after the fact. But for those that are watching now, it's just at Gwenya. Yeah, Sunshine Savannah posted it in the comment section there, so you can just follow that. Gwen, thank you very much. If there's any closing words that you would like to say, I'll give you the opportunity now.
Well, I probably will just use it to quickly, punt. Actually, I won't use it to punt the DA, but I will use it to punt liberal values and say that I think there are some people who are feeling generally quite despondent. But I think we should, I've always said, and I think I said it on that Renegade Report show as well, that, politics largely and elections are about available choices. And there's no political party that's ever going to be 100% perfect or 100% match your views. The DA doesn't match 100% of my views. I'm sure there's nobody in the DA who feels it matches 100% of their views. I'm sure ANC members feel the same, EFF members feel the same, and their corresponding voters feel the same. No party is designed in one person's image. So I think that it's very important to still participate in the voting or electoral process, because unless Roman leads an anarchist movement and gets his way, the likely reality is that we will have a political party that governs the country from now on onwards. And you might want to play a role in deciding who that will be, even if it means perhaps voting for a lesser evil and not your party of your dreams.
Mm. What makes me sleep at night is the fact that I know that Roman has to pay tax. Anyway, listen, thank you very much. It was an absolute honor, and good luck with your role as a member of parliament. And please just keep on doing what you're doing. You are, like I said, an example for so many people out there, and I see a lot of people saying they would gladly refer to you as Minister Gwen and Gwenya. So hopefully that's in the future for you.
I do feel I have to say in parting, because there's been a few jokes at Roman's expense, that he is a good friend of mine. I think we lost you. At least I'd like to
come back. Okay, there we go. Can you just repeat that, because we did lose you?
I just wanted to say, because there have been a few jokes at Roman's expense, to say that I actually am, well, at least I'd like to consider myself that I'm good friends with Roman. So yes, it's all said in good fun and jest, I hope.
Definitely, of course. Now, Roman was on here last week, and it's good to say that I've got an anarchist as a friend, because then I can always point and laugh and say I'm not that radical. So that's good, at least. I think that's where we're going to end it. Everybody, thank you so much for tuning in. Please sure to smash that like button. I think this video really does deserve a like. And the fact that there's only 3 dislikes on this video speaks of the volume, or speaks volumes for Gwen and Gwenya. So thank you very much. Also, please be sure to support me on Patreon. Please be sure to subscribe. I've got merch available, and this chat will continue with myself on my Discord channel. The link to all of those are in the description below. Gwen, thank you very much, and have a good Sunday.
Absolute pleasure. You too.
Cheers. And to everybody else out there, cheers and peace out.